join forces and seek intercession with some of the creation of Allah. And they think we should go to Adam first, because he's the father of the creation, he's our father. So they go to Adam and they will say, beg Allah to begin the judgment. Let Allah begin the judgment. Even if they know they're going to go to the hellfire, they just cannot stand the wait any longer. What will Adam say? Nafsi, nafsi. Myself, myself. Go to Nuh. So he will send them to Nuh. They will go to Nuh and they say, you are the first messenger Allah sent to the earth. Then they will praise Nuh. He will tell them, nafsi, nafsi. Myself, myself. Don't talk to me today. Allah has become angry. Go to Ibrahim. Ibrahim will send them to Musa. Musa will send them to Isa. And then Isa will send them to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Unlike the other prophets and messengers, he alayhi salatu wasalam will say, Ana laha. I am for it. I will take that particular responsibility. And he will prostrate and he will supplicate to Allah and he will praise Allah in a way where no human being has ever praised Allah. Until it will be said to him, raise your head, raise your head. Intercede and intercession will be granted to you. Ask and you will be given. Then he, alayhi salatu wasalam, among the things that he will say, Ummati, Ummati, my nation, my nation. All of the prophets in the Messenger will say, Nafsi, Nafsi, except the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will say, Ummati, Ummati, my nation, me and you. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, wa jazahallahu anna khayr al-jazah. Yes, this is the day of judgment. Now my brothers, a person may ask, Ya akhi, this sounds difficult. This is too much for me to handle. What if I was a righteous believer? What if I was a good Muslim? Do I get this particular treatment? Then we will say, no. This is where the hadith of Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu wa ardah comes. قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم سبعة يظلهم الله في ظله يوم لا ظل إلا ظله. Seven kinds of people, not seven individuals, don't misunderstand. Seven kinds of individuals, seven people with these qualities will be under the shade of Allah on the day where there is no shade but the shade of Allah. And this is where the topic came from. Under the shade of Allah. Who are they? You must want to know who are they in order for us to follow them, because you want to be on the shade, under the shade on that day. You don't want to be in the heat for 50,000 years. You don't want to be sweating for 50,000 years. And sure enough, you don't want to go to the hellfire after the 50,000 years are over and the judgment begins. So what then must the believer do to become qualified to be under the shade of Allah? Pay attention with me for the rest of the lecture with these seven qualities. The first one being Imamun Adilun, a just ruler. Now, although the hadith speaks about the ruler, this actually is related to us, those who are being ruled. Because the emphasis here is justice. Not only the ruler. Justice, adil, is something that is expected of me and you, my brothers in Islam. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُ بِالْعَدِلِ. Verily Allah enjoins, commands that you enjoin justice. You establish justice. So you have justice with your children, justice with your wives, justice with the believers, justice with the non-believers, justice with the animals, justice with the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A believer must be just. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the hadith al-Qudsi, Ya ibadi, inni harramtu al-zulma ala nafsi, wa ja'altahu baynakum muharrama, fala tazalamu. O my servants, I have made oppression forbidden upon myself, and I have made it forbidden upon you, so do not oppress one another. Inna al-zulma, inna shirka la-zulmun azeem. And the worst of zulm is ascribing partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then any kind of sin is a kind of zulm. So justice with ourselves is that we do not burden ourselves with sins. Hi brothers, justice with ourselves, each one of us with his own self, is by freeing yourself from sins. Sins that will shackle you. Sins that will handcuff you. In such a way where you're unable to move towards the path of guidance. See, the more we sin, the more you become firm in the ground. and it becomes, you become heavy. You cannot walk upon the path to paradise. It becomes difficult for you to move. People push you but you don't move. People remind you but you don't listen. People advise you but your heart is veiled. This is because of sins. And this is the consequences of dhulm. And this is the first thing that we must understand. Because that negates justice. So justice then with ourselves, justice with our family, with our children. The Prophet ﷺ said, اتقوا الله وأعدلوا بين أولادكم. Have taqwa of Allah. Be justice with your children. Don't give one of them a gift and leave the other one unattended. The Sahaba used to be so careful about this that if one of them kissed one of his children, he will kiss the other one. Because he was afraid that he will be oppressing one by kissing one without kissing the other. Nowadays, a parent may love one child and hate the other one. He gives this one goods and gifts and everything, and the other one, he doesn't even bother to call. This is unacceptable. So then the first quality is justice. We must establish justice in our lives. The second one, شَابٌ نَشَأَ فِي عِبَادَةِ اللَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ وَالْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ. We have a live example, بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ. Usually when I give this particular talk, there's no youth. Today we have a youth. The second quality is a young man, huh, who is brought up on the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Meaning from your tender age, you remain upon the path. You don't go left, right, zigzag, up, down, backwards, none of this stuff. From this age, you start learning the Quran, learning the Sunnah, learning the adab, the good character, the morals, and everything that Islam teaches, and you remain upon the path until you meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Young brothers, you are the future for this ummah. You may think that your responsibility is an honor for us, that you carry the responsibility of this ummah. We have hope in you, because now I'm speaking as if I'm 80 years old. I'm close to you, but that's how they feel about us, and I feel about you, because you're still younger than me. We have hope in you that you become the best Muslims, so the Muslim ummah will rise again. So inshallah ta'ala, you will be among those. Right now you have the chance to be qualified on this quality. A young man brought up on the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You'll be dutiful to your parents. When your mom and your dad tell you to do something, there's no negotiation. Huh? Go to the market, buy me some oranges. There's no, oh mom, but I'm playing the game. Mom, why are you back? None of this stuff. Huh? This negates being dutiful to the parents. You say, yes mom. You grab your stuff and you leave for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You are establishing the salah. You establish the salah. If you're above 7 years old, you should already learn how to pray. If you are 10 and above, you must be praying 5 daily prayers. Even Fajr. Huh? You teach the elders, you teach those older than you, how keen you are on the salah. You go to the masjid before they go to the masjid. So they will see an example in you. So when an older person who's not going to the masjid sees you in the masjid, he will feel ashamed of himself. He say, MashaAllah, what am I doing? Huh? So you'll be given da'wah by your actions. So inshallah, for the elder brothers who are disqualified, because maybe in your youth you were not exactly upon the obedience of Allah, don't worry, there's another 6 opportunities, 2 already mentioned and 3 to come, inshallah ta'ala. So maybe some of us are disqualified, we were not really brought up on the obedience of Allah. But by the mercy of Allah, there's room to make up. And this is one, the one that's coming right now, everyone here should be able to do. This is the easiest one and probably the most rewarding. What is it? The third one, رَجُلٌ قَلْبُهُ مُعَلَّقٌ بِالْمَسَاجِدِ. رَجُلٌ قَلْبُهُ مُعَلَّقٌ بِالْمَسَاجِدِ. A man whose heart is attached to the masjid. Now don't misunderstand, maybe some people think he will take his heart out, put it in a rope and leave it hanging in the masjid. Dakhi, where's your heart? Wallah, it's attached in the masjid. That's not what I'm talking about. Huh? Maybe the youth will misunderstand. We're not talking about leaving your heart in the masjid because you need your heart to be beating in order for you to remain alive. We are talking about the fact that this brother is so obsessed with Salatul Jama'ah that on he is constantly over-occupied with returning to the masjid. A man whose heart is attached to the masjid, as soon as he finishes Salat al-Fajr, he's already pre-planning for Salat al-Dhuhr. As soon as he finishes Dhuhr, he's pre-planning for Asr. As soon as Asr to Maghrib and from Maghrib to Isha. He's always occupied with the masjid. Why? Because he believes in the Quran. And if you read Surah An-Nur, you will find something amazing. When Allah described the masajid, He mentioned some amazing qualities of these men. He said, عز وجل, في بيوت أذن الله أن ترفع ويذكر فيها اسمه يسبح له فيها بالغدو والآصال رجال رجال لا تليهم تجارة ولا بيع عن ذكر الله وإقام الصلاة وإيتاء الزكاة ليه؟ يخافون يوما تتقلب فيه القلوب والأبصار. Allah, when he praised the masajid in the Quran, He said in houses which Allah allowed for them to be risen, both physically as far as construction and in the remembrance of Allah inside, where people remember Allah. He said where the name of Allah is being remembered and celebrated and mentioned in the morning and in the evening. Now notice what the verse after says. The beginning of the second verse says, رجال. By who? By men. An indication that the more you are attached to the message